person to join our broader conversation on today's topics by following @Atlantic_live and tweeting your thoughts on today's discussion using the hashtag AtlanticWow. With campaign season underway, we are bringing together two leading political strategists, Stephanie Cutter and Katie Packer. Today's conversation will discuss the year's upcoming elections and the 2016 presidential race. Stephanie Cutter worked on Obama's reelection campaign as deputy campaign manager and now doubles as partner of Precision Strategies and co-host of CNN's Crossfire. And before founding Burning Glass, an all-female consulting firm, Katie Packer served as deputy campaign manager of the Romney for President campaign in 2012. Mary Louise Kelly, contributing editor of The Atlantic, will lead our discussion. A few notes of housekeeping before we begin. If everyone could silence your cell phones, since we'll be live streaming the discussion. We'll open for questions from the audience after the main discussion, and please wait for a member of our team to come around with a microphone and identify yourselves. And we're ready to dive into our conversation. And let's welcome our guests to the stage. And Mary Louise, I am going to hand things off to you.
Thank you, Emily. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Hey. Oh. Hello. Great pleasure to share the afternoon with all of you. We are we're fond of noting around the Atlantic offices that we refer to this event as WOW. So I've been looking forward all week to sharing the afternoon with the women of Washington and any men who are out there too. You're most welcome. So thanks to you both for being here, Stephanie Cutter and Katie Packer. I want to start by noting this. You were deputy campaign manager for the Romney campaign in 2012. At the same time, Stephanie, as you were deputy campaign manager for the president's reelection campaign, does that mean that for about a year or so there, basically your jobs were waking up every morning and thinking up new ways to drive each other crazy?
Probably.
Mine was. I can't speak for you.
Not necessarily overtly to drive each other crazy. That was just sort of a side effect, I suppose.
What is that like? I mean, people say you can't possibly understand the pace of a presidential campaign unless you've been on the inside of it. Do you ever get time to go out and get your highlights done or go to the grocery store? Does that just not happen for a year?
Well, sure. I mean, you find time for things like that that'll keep you sane. My time in Boston was about 6:30 on Friday night, typically. I had a standing massage appointment at this wonderful little spa there in the North End that was just sort of like my sanity. It felt like that was the time that reporters kind of chilled out. They started going out for their weekend drinks. And, you know, you could just sort of get a chance to feel human again. Things just sort of quieted down a little bit. And then Sunday mornings, a lot of people, believe it or not, are still at church.
Yeah.
So
were you glued to the Sunday morning shows?
Sure, we were. But, Stephanie had a different role. So Sunday mornings probably weren't quite as peaceful for her. We were sort of just watching what was coming out of the Sunday shows, and if our candidate was on, had a more sort of offensive role. But you don't really get very much time, and it very much feels like you're in a bunker, that nobody really understands what you're going through. It's almost hard to even relate to your friends and family that are kind of on the outside, because it's just so intense and it's all-consuming, and so that kind of becomes your family for that period of time. But I can't say there's anything I've ever done that's quite like it. You find yourself in the last few weeks envying the person that works at the 7-Eleven counter, thinking, wow, I bet you she just goes home after work and nobody bothers her. But it's also really exhilarating, and there's a quality to it that once you've done it, I think you always think, how am I ever going
to
get that?
How do you live up to that again?
Yeah.
Stephanie, your nickname inside the Obama campaign, I'm told, was the Ninja. Did you know this at the time?
No, I think that was a fabricated thing from a competitor paper. This last campaign was, I think, my fifth presidential campaign. So I felt like I had been through it before, which it definitely helps in managing the stress and understanding what the things that you do need to do and the things that you really don't need to get worked up on. Mm-hmm. And I had done plenty of presidential campaigns where I never took time for myself. I never thought of what was happening outside of that campaign or the need to exercise or to get your highlights done or to realize that, you know, that every last battle wasn't the battle to end all battles. And, you know, going through it a couple of times gives you more perspective. And this time around, I was also coming from the White House. So as busy as campaigns are, the White House is that much worse. So it was almost a little bit of a break by the time
wow.
I got to the campaign.
Well, that just makes me angry.
But also... or you can see how pathetic it was, too. But we were also not in a primary. And Katie was in a primary,
right.
And there's a big difference.
She'd run a marathon.
She had run a marathon before our race even started, and we had the pleasure of sitting back and watching that marathon and trying to poke the bear along the way, and prepare for when there was a nominee and sort of disrupt him as he was emerging. And there's a big difference in terms of the energy in a campaign. You know, I've also been on the other side of it, coming out of a primary into a general mm-hmm. in 2004. And by the time you get to the general, you're absolutely exhausted. You're out of money. You think you're out of ideas because you've used every last good idea. And it's harrowing to think I've got another 5 months of this. Right.
And you're almost out of hate.
You're like, I'll find you when, just so I can go get my massage done at this point.
Yeah. We had this feeling coming out of the primary, and I don't think this, I think I've said this publicly before, but inside our campaign, there was a lot more hate for Rick Santorum in April of 2012 than there was for Barack Obama. You know, we had been going toe-to-toe every week, and it's not like a general where you get to the general and then it's done. It was an election one day, and then another election right. 5 days later, and then another election a week later, and it was just relentless. And so we found, you know, they were looking at us as the enemy. We were still kind of like, oh my God, we've just killed the enemy. And we hadn't quite yet worked up the aggression that we really needed to have for a general election. So it is a very different sort of ebb and flow.
Well, let me bring us up to where we are in this election cycle. There was a poll out today, New York Times, CBS, newest poll showing Trump with a commanding lead in the Republican field at 35%. The next are Cruz at 16%, Carson at 13%, Rubio I think was at 9%, and everybody else was single digits, around 4% or so. But the interesting thing I thought, 64% of GOP voters said it's too early to have firmly made up my mind. Is that typical for this, for early December in the election cycle? Is that a typical number of people who haven't, or they're not, they, you know, they might be leaning one way or the other, but they're not quite sure yet. It could go either way.
Well, a lot, that's a national poll. Mm-hmm. So nationally, people are really just watching the news and reading the paper, and that's how they're getting their information. But if you look in Iowa or New Hampshire, where ads are running constantly, and it's a constant topic of conversation, and they're just getting hit at the door, on the TV, on their phone, on the internet, every which way. I think, and I'm sure there are numbers on this, I just haven't seen the recent one, but I think more people have probably made up their mind in those early states. Mm-hmm. So the numbers to be looking at right now are the state numbers, which I don't think they're all that different than the national poll. Trump is ahead everywhere except Iowa. Mm-hmm. And Cruz is up in Iowa, and I think Rubio is in third place more often than Carson is, and Carson is in third place nationally. But that's where the fluidity it is, and those are the numbers that matter. And my guess is that probably 2/3 of voters have probably made up their mind in those states.
I should mention, too, that the New York Times CBS poll was conducted before Monday when Trump mm-hmm. made the remarks about that Muslims should not be allowed to enter the United States. We don't know how that will play out in the next set of poll numbers, but this poll did not reflect that. I mean, you mentioned people in Iowa, people in New Hampshire, people in the early voting states are getting bombarded. We're inside of 2 months now, February 1st. Iowa caucuses, February 9th, I believe, is New Hampshire. Is there a date that you look to when this is your business? where you start to think, okay, now we know where this is going? Or is it all up in the air till, say, Super Tuesday?
I think it's really, really up in the air. If you look at, and more so this time than ever before because of the number of candidates.
Yeah.
If you looked at the polls and I just was going back and forth with some reporters today on this, in 2011, Mitt Romney basically had decided we weren't going to compete in Iowa. We just weren't going to go down that road again. We had done it in 2008 and were not successful. And so he just planted his flag in New Hampshire. And then we woke up in December of 2011 and we were ahead in Iowa. And so we were like, well, shoot, you know, maybe we'll give this a try. Maybe we can win. You know, we haven't had to make a big investment. And there's sort of this misnomer that the candidate that spends the most time in the state and goes to all these events is automatically going to win. And we had spent almost no time there. And so we started to play, and we only had a month. The Iowa caucuses were right after New Year's last time. And so, you know, we played for about 3 weeks. I think Mitt, you know, did as many events in December as he had done in the whole rest of 2011. And I don't know if you all remember, but on caucus day, he won. And then it was so close, though, that about a week and a half later, they gave the win to Santorum. But it was virtually a tie.
Right.
And Santorum had spent no time anywhere but Iowa. And Mitt had spent no time in Iowa. So it's not necessarily reflective, but people do really start to focus in as it gets closer. I think the difficulty right now is, you know, what hasn't changed is we've got, you know, roughly, you know, depending on the day, you know, 65 to 75% of Republican primary voters that have said, no, I don't want Donald Trump. But it's very hard for them to kind of hone in on who they do want because it's virtually impossible to see any other candidate featured on the news. I mean, he has just created this total sort of eclipse that it's very difficult for these other candidates to tell their story and to make a case. I do think that until some of these candidates drop out, not because they're hogging poll numbers, but because they're blurring the race, mm-hmm. that it's going to be, it's just going to sort of sit like this. And we really need to get this race down to, you know, the three or four candidates that have a real shot so that the Republican voters can sort of focus in. And it's going to be a lot easier for them to go Trump, Cruz, Rubio, Christie.
Is that who you would put up as the four?
Well, not necessarily.
Most likely at this point?
I mean, I think it's Trump, Cruz, Rubio, and then maybe one other. But it's going to be a lot easier for them to sort of say, okay, with these four, I know who I'm for. But if you're, you know, super big on foreign policy, you might like, you know, what Lindsey Graham has to say.
Well, you touch on this is what I am really struggling to understand with the conversation over the last few weeks since Paris and with the shootings in San Bernardino. This conversation has really shifted nationally to issues of national security, terrorism. Why aren't Republican voters flocking to the candidate that has more national security experience? Why has that not changed the way these polls are looking? I mean, instead they are solidifying, the lead seems to be solidifying for the candidate with the least national security experience with no government experience whatsoever. That's mystifying to me.
Well, none of them really have any significant national security experience. You know, I guess you could argue that Rubio does for his couple of years in the Senate, but, you know, you've got mostly governors. I think that's what makes this race so unpredictable, because it's not based on fact. In fact, Trump supporters are clear that they don't care about facts. They don't care if he lies. They don't care if he distorts the truth. It's just the sentiment that he's communicating that is drawing them to him. And it's a rhetoric, it's isolationist, it's kill them before they kill us, it's, you know, it's insulting, it's, you know, all of these things that are tapping into an anger, really, and a certain segment of the Republican base. And not even the base, you know, you couldn't even say that Trump supporters are really the base. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a strain of anger on the Democratic side, too. We don't have a Trump on our side, but there's a similar strain. And that's what they're drawn to. You know, that's what makes this so unpredictable, because you don't know that as they're going to the polls or to the caucus, whichever state you're in, whether or not they're going to finally think, like, yeah, I agree with what he's saying, but is he really a commander-in-chief? And this guy over here, this woman over here, is saying a lot of the same things, but she seems more presidential, and then they switch their vote. It's really hard to figure out whether that support for Trump is that soft, because we've never really seen anything like it. We've never seen a candidate like this. Hmm. And we've never seen, as Katie said, the treatment of a candidate like this. Mm-hmm. We're in an unpredictable state of our politics, and if Trump wins, which as an American I'm fearful of, but also as a Democrat, I think it makes the general pretty unpredictable too. No one's been able to figure out the secret sauce here.
I was going to ask, I mean, whether or not he becomes the eventual Republican candidate or whether he flames out at some point in the winter and spring to come, it has been a candidacy that I don't think we've quite seen the likes of, certainly not in my generation in America. What's the impact going to be on the general election and on campaigns to come of the rancor that he has sparked, but also to be fair, the energy that he's sucking into this race?
I think that he hasn't actually sparked the rancor so much as he has channeled it. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you've got sort of this dangerous combination of, celebrity, somebody that's very skilled at self-promotion and you can say a lot of things about him, but he's genius at capturing the media cycle. And what I think he has sort of tapped into that I think is dangerous in both the primary and the general is there is this universe of white, sort of middle class and working class voters who feel very disenfranchised. They don't care about government experience because they don't feel like the government is working and that the government has worked for them. They've sort of been forced into this place where they feel like they have to be politically correct. And, they hear people say, it's not okay to say all lives matter, only black lives matter. It's not okay to say, radical Islam, because that's taking, that's declaring war on a religion. It's not okay to say this, this, and this. But the reality is that when they're sitting around in coffee shops in small town America, those are the things that they're talking about.
Right.
So when they hear a candidate, however incendiary he might be, saying the things that they're saying, they all of a sudden think, somebody gets me. Somebody gets what I'm angry about. And he's giving voice to something. And I do think that the rest of these candidates could learn something from that. And certainly, I don't want to see them go the way of Trump. But I do think if they can figure out a way to understand that frustration, and that is a significant part of the Republican base. The Republican base is very white and very, rural and very sort of flyover country. And, I think these other candidates on both sides of the aisle would be wise to really listen to the anger and the frustration and try to figure out how they can be the answer to that question.
I guess I agree in part of what Katie said, but I disagree in another part. I agree that Trump has found a way to talk to this segment of the electorate in a way that clearly connects with them. And the Republican Party has to figure out a way to increase the percentage of white voters that come out and actually vote. I don't think we know yet how many of these Trump supporters are actual voters, and in an election that really matters. But from what, and I'm not a Republican voter and I'm not a Republican campaign official, but I do still get intelligence from what's happening on the ground in places like Iowa. And on the Democratic side, we've picked up that Trump is registering voters. Mm-hmm. And he is collecting email addresses and he's creating a base and he's doing all of the smart things that you need to do in an early primary state. So it'll be interesting. I mean, Barack Obama won Iowa by bringing what we called unlikely voters or infrequent voters out, maybe somebody who hadn't voted in the last election or had skipped two elections, that people weren't counting in their vote counts. We won by finding those voters and getting them out to the polls. So if that's what Trump does in Iowa, then that means a lot for the general election, for the Republican Party. The problem that it creates for the Republican Party is that those voters are coming out for a very particular person, Donald Trump. And even if Donald Trump collapses at a state further down the road, you know, they're in this race because of Donald Trump. And for another Republican candidate to keep them in the tent, you know, Trump has set a bar that is not particularly pretty. And they're going to have to figure out a way to, you know, for lack of a better term, stoop to that level to keep those people in the tent. So that creates a danger, I think, for not just the Republican Party, but for our overall state of politics.
Stephanie, what's the view on all this from Hillary land? And I should mention that Precision Strategies, where your partner is working with her campaign, can you give a little glimpse behind the curtain into the war room?
I can't. The work that we do.
It seems like she's sitting there. Yeah. If I were her, I'd be rubbing my hands in glee, just watching the Republican side of the race all do themselves in, saying as little as possible.
I can give you my opinion, but I don't speak for the Hillary campaign, and I don't have inside intelligence of what's happening in the war room. The work we do for her is different. But, you know, I think that they are watching. You know, at this point in a race, you know, the Democrats have a primary, absolutely, so it's not completely like 2012, but it's a less competitive primary than what you're seeing on the Republican side. And at this point, you want to try to figure out who could be the Republican frontrunner and how you can start locking them into some pretty unsavorable positions that they're going to have to deal with in the general election. Right. Well, that's happening every single day, and because of
you're
Trump.
You're welcome.
So my guess is that they're, you know, keeping pretty good records and making sure that people are taking note, you know, the media, of things that people are saying and doing. They're collecting video. They're putting ads together and figuring out how they're going to run against certain people. And there's a lot of ammunition that's being built. So I think that's probably what they're doing. I will also say, from my perspective, I do worry about the unpredictability in this, that pollsters, political experts, media, campaign opponents, you name it, no one has been able to figure out why Trump's numbers keep going up. Every time a poll comes out, somebody says, well, that must be his ceiling. Right. He's not going to get any greater share of the vote. And certainly with this blunder, he's going to drop. It never happens. And nobody can figure out why. And if that's happening in the Republican, certainly a Republican primary is not the same as a general election, and you have about, you know, 60% different voters that you're dealing with. I do think that there is an element of unpredictability in a general election. Whether Trump is the nominee or not, there's something happening in the electorate.
How much of that do both of you think is due to some of the forces at play now that weren't in some of the earlier? I mean, you said you've been through five campaigns, and you think about what all's changed in terms of polling, in terms of the rise of super PACs, in terms of the changes in the way that the 24-hour news cycle works and how much faster campaigns have to react and get their messages out, demographic changes in the country. What, I mean, as you look at kind of how this campaign is unfolding compared to how something was unfolding 20 years ago, what do you think are the biggest game changers?
Well, I think that, I hate to say this because I do a lot of work with my friends in cable news, but I think cable news has become a caricature of what news used to be about. It has really just, in this cycle, turned into an entertainment exercise. And, you know, they like to say, and I put this much more on the TV folks than I do on the print folks, but, you know, they like to say, well, he's leading in the polls, so of course we cover him all the time. Mitt Romney was very much seen as the front runner, whether he was leading in the polls or not. There was a sense in 2012 that he was going to be the nominee. But I don't ever remember, you know, breaking news in an evening being his plane landing in a state to do an event. And yet several times I've seen, you know, breaking news alert, you know, Donald Trump is arriving in Alabama.
Right.
And they know that people will tune in, that they tune into the spectacle, and so they're taking advantage of it for the purpose of ratings, which is fine. I just don't think that you should call that news. And I do think it's done a disservice to some of these other candidates that are legitimate candidates and could eventually become president, that we're not seeing, you know, sort of a fair and balanced effort to showcase their views. And I'm not saying that you should do that for all 15. You know, some of them don't have a legitimate shot, but it shouldn't just be about, you know, who's the guy that's going to give us the most ratings and we're going to feature him, you know, 80% of the time. And I do think that it has had an impact, and it's made it very, very difficult for any other candidate, and, you know, to break out. I don't think it's the reason that Donald Trump is leading, but I think it is the reason that no other candidate has been able to coalesce any, you know, significant amount of support.
But he is very adept at manipulating the news cycle. You're reminding me, somebody had a great line recently. I think it might have been David Brooks, When in Doubt in This Town, a tribute to David Brooks, or Shakespeare, somebody the other day talked about Jeb Bush and said he would have been a great candidate in the 1950s, but his style doesn't necessarily translate to 2015. Do you agree?
I do agree. And I have come to the conclusion, although I was at one time a very big Jeb Bush fan, you know, back in the 90s when he was governor, I don't know if he was ever a good candidate. And he's a very good guy and was certainly a good governor by Republican standards. And a lot of people have said if he had gotten nominated or if he had gotten elected as governor of Florida in 94, that he probably would have been president instead of George W. Bush. I don't think that's true. I do think that running for president of the United States is a unique proposition that requires unique skills that George W. Bush had and that Jeb does not have. And if you look at his history, in 1994, he ran in a year that it was really hard to lose for Republicans, and he lost. And then he ran again in 98, another year that was really hard to lose for Republicans, and he won. So he never had a big, you know, sort of purple state win that was unexpected like a Chris Christie or a Marco Rubio did, you know, that would say, you know, he's this kind of head and shoulders above the crowd candidate. And so I think we're just seeing that he just lacks some natural political skills that are required to run for president of the United States. I don't think anybody would have argued in 2008 that Hillary Clinton, on paper, was a stronger candidate than Barack Obama. But Barack Obama had sort of mad political skill that is very, very hard to fake.
Mm-hmm. Charisma. Weigh in here.
I agree. Yeah. I think that Jeb just seems like he's always a step behind. It's now become a sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy that's going to be really hard for him to break.
And what about, you know, this criticism of the news media, and you can argue, I mean, the news media would argue we're covering him in proportion to the public interest that and poll numbers, and he's the lead candidate. Therefore, we're going to give him more time than anybody else. And
Donald Trump?
Over how that becomes a self-fulfilling
prophecy. They were covering him
prophecy.
Before he was the lead candidate. I mean, it was breaking news when he made his announcement. They didn't cover anybody else's announcement. So, you know, no other candidate can just pick up the phone and call into Morning Joe or the Today Show
or meet the press.
Like, that doesn't happen. It's never happened. Never happened for any candidate that I worked for, including a president. So, you know, that's different treatment. And they should just call it what it is. It's different treatment. It helps their bottom line. It's certainly a savory story. And he's pure entertainment. I mean, he is a celebrity because he's entertaining. You know, that's his profession. And things like his bankruptcies or his marriages or his shady business deals or... you know, only now are press starting to pat themselves on the back for asking him tough questions and holding him accountable for the things that he's saying that are just flat out false. That's only recently, within the last month, I think, when he made the statement about people celebrating after 9/11. Mm-hmm. That's when it started, and certainly the recent Muslim comments the press have been tough on. But you kind of let the bear out of the cage already, so it's hard to pull him back in. And that bear was let out of the cage many months ago.
And he hasn't had anything like the scrutiny that Ben Carson got or that any of the candidates in 2008 that ultimately, you know, emerged and then fell. And Stephanie brings up a great point. You can argue all you want. We're covering him because he's the leader. But then scrutinize him like he's the leader. You don't think that another candidate that had been married and divorced and cheated on spouses as often as he has in Iowa would have been scrutinized and that we'd know all the ins and outs. I'm not even saying that that's legitimate. I'm just saying it would have happened.
It would have happened.
To anybody else.
Mitt Romney's business deals and how much scrutiny that got.
Absolutely.
His business deals are like, you know, St. Peter compared to what Donald Trump has done. So I don't, you know, and none of that is being looked at. This man has filed bankruptcy multiple times. Can you imagine a president of the United States who has filed bankruptcy only to cheat out creditors? That's the only reason he's doing it. It's not because he's out of money. He's cheating out creditors.
And I do. I mean, just to...
Did you expect this for us to agree on
yeah.
so much?
But that's what I...
Really
and I'm
disappointed.
Not, I'm saying
have
this...
To change gears
and I know nobody will believe me. I'm not saying this as a Democrat. I'm saying this as an American. Like, I cannot believe that we're even talking about this man as a potential president.
It's absolutely true. And I mean, there is so much... And I actually wonder sometimes, is that the reason the media doesn't scrutinize him? Because there's just so much that where do you start? You know, he's yeah. done two major feature presentations or appearances, one with Barbara Walters, you know, prime time, you know, hour-long feature, one on 60 Minutes. Not one really substantive, you know, deep dive into any of these things that we're talking about. It's unbelievable to me.
Well, and I guess I would add, you know, in defense of my brethren on the front line trying to cover the campaign, I feel like there has been some good investigative reporting done that with the people who are backing him just doesn't have a lot of traction. It's as one of
well,
you
do
said,
we know,
they just don't care.
But do we know how either of his,
he's been
either his first or third wife became a citizen of this country? His whole campaign is premised on the issue of immigration and certain people coming in and certain people not coming in. And we don't even know how his two wives became U.S. citizens. I think that, at a minimum, would seem like a legitimate, you know, course of inquiry.
Yeah. All right, reporters out there, take note. Let me ask, where do you two get your news from? What do you wake up and check first thing in the morning?
Multiple sources. I don't read
Do you check
news
your email first or Twitter
to.
First? Or it sounds like you're not turning on... cable news.
No, I have a almost 2-year-old, so I'm normally doing that in the morning. And by the time you get to work, it's too late to read the news because you're already going. So I am not as much of a news hound as I once was. But you know, I look online at CNN, mm-hmm. New York Times. I look at news aggregators a lot, and try to glimpse at the news throughout the day. But I'm not as much of a
Do you find
well,
that
political
helps because you're not reacting? Sorry, one sec. But do you find that helps because you're not ping-ponging to react to what the latest thing was?
Well, you
have a little bit of a
even
perspective.
Even in 2012, I had a rule for, you know, I oversaw communications and policy and research that we weren't going to have cable news on because we weren't.
Really? Inside the Obama
yeah, absolutely. That wasn't how we were going to make our decisions. And because, you know, our targets were the woman sitting on her couch in Ohio who just put her kids to bed, or, you know, the man who just got home from work in New Hampshire. Those were our targets. And they weren't glued to CNN or to Fox News. They were, Fox News weren't our voters anyway, but, or MSNBC. They, you know, they'd probably DVR'd their local news. So it was more important for us to be looking at the local news and trying to get on the local news or figure out a way, you know, we had lots of data available to us, figuring out how they were already interacting with the campaign and the best way to be communicating with them. And quite often it wasn't through the news. It was by sending somebody to their door or working through our neighborhood team leader to get the material and creating a two-way conversation. So it's much more complex than just, you know, I've been through 5 of these and... Many years ago, you could just put out a press release and you'd get headline news across the board. It doesn't work that way anymore. News cycles, there's about 100 of them during any given day and 100 different sources that your targets are looking at any point during the day. So you have to kind of figure out how they're going to get their information and how they're going to get information that sinks in, not just exposure, but that they care about.
K Katie, I cut you off. Forgive me. You were going to tell us what did you wake up and read in the morning?
Operatives are sort of cheaters because we usually have, you know, clips from either the DNC or the RNC that, you know, they sort of synthesize. And sometimes
this
you can find a big fat email calling
that lands in your inbox in the morning.
Just an ongoing sort of reel of, you know, things that are breaking, important stories. So somebody else is deciding what news you see. And sometimes you find yourself at the end of the day and something big has happened, like in Hollywood or something, right, and you weren't even aware of it because it doesn't rank as political news. And then, of course, you know, I'm on Twitter all the time. And so, you know, I follow most of the national political reporters. And so, you know, if something happens on the trail, you pick things up there. But, you know, like Stephanie said, you know, on our campaign, I don't think, you know, people were very attached to cable news. You know, the war room, you know, has them all on and is, you know, monitoring it throughout the day. But it wasn't something where, you know, we were all sort of sitting around glued to, you know.
And what did you find actually was useful in terms of reaching voters and communicating with them?
Well, 2012 was sort of the birth of Twitter on a presidential campaign. And so that was sort of a new tool, you know, that had some strengths and weaknesses and, you know, some drawbacks. And it was, I think it's, the use of it has become a little better policed by the media. At that time, it was kind of the Wild West. And, you know, a lot of these really young reporters, you know, Stephanie was working on the president's campaign. So sort of the best reporters get assigned to that beat.
Right.
you know, we had people that were embedded on our campaign, you know, from, you know, March of 2011, that had just gotten out of college, and they didn't have very much, you know, in terms of real-world media experience. And so to have reporters that all of a sudden aren't having to go through an editor but are able to just, you know, relate news as they see it was a little bit dangerous, and it changed the pace pretty dramatically.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's been both fabulous and terrifying from the reporter's point of view. As you say, it used to be, If a candidate wanted their message out, you got a press release, and the public relied on you to disseminate it. And that's obviously, you know, feels so 2005.
Yeah. Not I the had way somebody recently, like a Republican Party county chair from Michigan, asked me to fax him something the other day.
And you thought, what?
You know, he's like up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, and I was like, let me think about that. Does FedEx, you know, have a fax machine? Maybe. I don't know how to fax anything anymore. But, I mean, this is a guy who's responsible for the Republican Party outreach in his county, and that's how he gets his information. So somebody better figure out how to communicate with him.
I'm going to open it up to the audience in just a minute. But first, I wonder if both of you would share just a little bit of your personal story with us. I was talking to people in the coffee line, and they were saying, how did they get where they are? How do you become a high power political consultant inside the presidential campaign or the Republican candidate campaign, and I'm curious if you would share. Was this something? When did you decide this was, you wanted to go into politics? You wanted to go into campaigning? How did you find your way to where you are? Do you want to start, Katie?
Sure. I had no intention of going into this. I wanted to be Gloria Ditas. I wanted to be a PR person. And because I was living in Texas, and because of some family, you know, health concerns with my mom, I moved back home. My sister got me a job. You know, she was in politics, and she got me a job working in the state capitol in Michigan. And I was working for the Senate Majority Leader, and there was a special election, like 3 months into my working there, and they asked me if I would be interested in taking a leave of absence to go work on this campaign, and I was like, well, okay, yeah, whatever you tell me to do, you're my boss. So if you think I should do that, sure. And I went up there, and it was, you know, like sort of getting struck by a lightning bolt. Like the rush of every single day trying to win the day was so exciting to me. And I, you know, I never really went back to respectable work after that. I did, you know, I worked on the presidential campaign in 1992, and then a handful of, you know, state legislative races. I was the state director for Dole in 1996, was involved in the second President Bush's presidential campaigns. And then ultimately, I was actually in the consulting business, and then Mitt Romney started sort of sniffing around running for president. And, you know, I'm a Michigan person, born and raised in Michigan, and, you know, I love the idea of a Michigan guy. His dad was governor of our state, and he was born and raised about, you know, 3 miles from where I grew up. And I just felt a connection because of all that. And so I really sought him out. And, you know, very early on, you know, about 2 years before, pretty much right after he got elected governor.
Oh, really?
And
you were starting
wanted
to sniff around and say, if this were to happen, bring me along for the ride.
Yeah, I just wanted to help. And so I ended up working on the primary in 2008, and then sort of stayed involved between 2008 and 2012. And, you know, Michigan was one of the few states that he won in 2008. And so I think it was something that, you know, sort of, you know, he felt a great affection for me because I helped him to win the state that his dad had been governor. And I think he would have been very sad to have lost that. So I just stayed involved, and then he asked me to come on in a very senior role in 2012.
What's the most fun you've had on the campaign trail?
Oh, wow. The last campaign in 2012, in spite of losing, I really loved the whole time except for election night. It was, you know, it was grueling and exhausting, but it was also something where I had a great team that I worked with. I don't think a lot of losing campaigns were as close and as positive in terms of the experience as our team was. There's, you know, you won't find a lot of people crapping on Mitt or the campaign after the fact.
Which is rare, yeah.
It's very rare. And we had a great run. You know, the night that that Santorum stepped out of the race was a very fun, exciting night for us, and we celebrated. You know, the convention, of course, you know, it's kind of a celebration of all that you've been working so hard for, and the night that he spoke, that was a really fun and exciting night. In terms of the general election, probably our high water mark was the Denver debate. You know, this, you know, that was an event that people, you know, had very high expectations. It's hard to debate a sitting president, and Mitt had a very, very good night that night. And I think that was the first time that it really felt like the party kind of coalesced behind Mitt, that he was no longer just the guy that had won. He was now the leader of the party. And it really felt like a sea change that night. So those are some of the highlights.
Stephanie, how about you? How did you end up where you've ended up? What was the path?
Well, it was not a path that I ever charted. You know, I was always exposed to politics growing up. My grandfather was very involved. Seems like we're always in the back of a car going to a rally or marching in a parade or something. And I was always interested in politics and was very active in high school and college for causes, not necessarily candidates. And when I graduated from college, I knew I wanted to move to Washington, but I graduated as a dual major in government and economics, so I thought I wanted to be an economist. Mm-hmm. So I was applying for jobs at the Fed and also jobs for... you know, I really wanted to work for Mario Cuomo. So couldn't have two more different pathways. And I ended up getting a job with Mario Cuomo in 91. And that's when he was thinking about running for president. I really wanted to run for president. I was heartbroken when he didn't. And ended up joining the Clinton campaign, but also starting law school because I also thought I wanted to be a lawyer. And ended up going to law school at night while working for Clinton in the White House and becoming a lawyer. And I was doing policy work, wasn't even doing communications or press work. And then decided I didn't want to be a lawyer. and kind of just fell into what I'm doing now. I had the combination of policy and law and communications and sort of just kind of fell into these particular roles. Stayed in the Clinton administration for all 8 years. Was fortunate to go work for Ted Kennedy after that, which was, you know, for Massachusetts, Irish girl was the chance of a lifetime. And my mother, you know, after graduating at the top of my class in law school, working for President Clinton, when I got a job with Ted Kennedy, my mother said, finally, you finally done something.
Something worthwhile.
So that shows you how my family thinks. And, you know, ended up working for John Kerry, my other home state senator. And again, kind of just falling into these jobs. I got dragged into the Kerry campaign because he had a shakeup in the fall of 2003. And Senator Kennedy asked me if I would just go do this to get John through New Hampshire. So New Hampshire, you know, we won Iowa and we won New Hampshire. It kept going. And I kept saying, I thought you said this was just through New Hampshire. So it was just things like that. After 2004, I went back to the Senate. I had met Barack Obama in 2004 when he was speaking at the convention. so I went back to the Senate in a hybrid role between Harry Reid, who was the minority leader, ultimately the majority leader, and Ted Kennedy running, getting ready for the 2006 elections, and got to meet, got to work with Barack Obama, and that's how I really got to know him. So when he decided to run for president, I had sworn off another campaign, wasn't going to do it again, and eventually got pulled onto that campaign, and you know, then the next 7 years were quickly written. And so if anybody tells you that in politics, with the exception of a few people who have run for office, and, if they've ever had a plan, not in my experience is a plan even possible.
Well, I'll ask you the opposite question that I asked Katie. Worst moment. And I mentioned this, we should, for people who don't know, you mentioned that you were working for Kerry, you were working for him when he got Swift voted, you were working with Tim Geithner when he was defending the bailout and other, how should we put it, unpopular policies. You were working with Bill Clinton throughout the Monica Lewinsky scandal and the impeachment proceedings. And the worst, tell me if this is not true, but according to the New York Times, which profiled you a couple years ago, you were assigned the unenviable task of telling Sonia Sotomayor, when she was getting prepped for her confirmation hearings for the Supreme Court, telling her to tone down her jangly earrings. True? Worst moment?
No.
No.
Not by far.
All right. What was?
And that wasn't to have her tone down her jangly earrings. It was that, you know, you don't want people writing about what you're wearing. You want people writing about what you're saying in an introductory role like that. That was for her rollout. But interesting, somebody, I have to go back and read these stories. I think that the worst night was probably when we lost in 2004. Mm-hmm. You know, I had spent the day in a room with John Kerry, and that's back in the day where you just did satellite interviews nonstop throughout Election Day, and you timed it according to when the polls opened and when the polls closed and who had the longest lines, and it was just you tried to target the candidate to encourage your voters to get out there and vote. And so I was literally in a room with him doing satellite interviews for about 5 hours. So we had no access to polls, no access to exits. We were just churning these things out. So I walked out of that room with him, and somebody said, it was probably about 6 o'clock, may I be the first to congratulate you, Mr. President. So I'm like, hey, great, we won. That's great. and then slowly, throughout the course of the night, the story changed pretty quickly. And this was all based on exit polls that people were congratulating him. And, you know, pretty soon we didn't win Florida. In fact, we lost Florida by a significant margin where we had projected ourselves up to. And then when certain counties started to go in Ohio, it was clear we weren't going to win. It was me and the campaign manager who had to break the news to the senator and stay up and figure out how we were going to plan a concession speech. And that was probably the hardest day in my life in politics. Yeah. And it was a very long day. It was 3 days. so that was probably I guess the other one was when Senator Kennedy got sick and managing that. That was probably the hardest day, too.
Questions? Let me open it up. We have mics out here. If you raise your hand, we can get a mic to you if you identify yourself. I see one in this corner.
Okay, thank you very much. I have been curious about the polls. It seems like we're in a time of flux where people don't have landlines, where it's harder to get a good reading Obama did, but that was with a whole lot of other stuff, as I understand it. So what is the state of the polls today?
Why don't you take this one, Stephanie?
Well, I think that, Nancy, you are right. We are in flux. Because people don't have landlines, and it's really hard to get somebody to engage in a poll on a mobile phone. So more and more people are starting to rely on online polling, but until this cycle, online polling was very unpredictable, hard to really know what type of sample you were getting. You had a creative relationship with people online. It couldn't be as random as just picking up the voter file. Because you have to expand your universe so much just to get enough of a response for the sample. I think that's where the trend is going for online polls. You know, for President Obama, we knew that polls were in flux. We used several different buckets. We had a national benchmark poll. We had state polls. We had an online universe that we had held throughout the course of the campaign, which was basically an online focus group where you couldn't get a state of the race from them, but you could certainly get instant reaction to certain things, mm-hmm. which was a good barometer for us. But we also had a massive data operation where we were making 9,000 phone calls a night into the battleground states to get constantly figure out exactly where the race was. And you would have the same series of questions that you'd ask about support numbers and favorability, and then throw in a couple of other more current questions to figure out how the race was updating itself. You know, through all of those sources, we saw a very stable race throughout the campaign from about April of 2012 on. The numbers, you know, only shifted 1 or 2 points up and down. No big fluctuations, even after the disastrous Denver debate. there wasn't a lot of fluctuation, at least that we saw. So, you know, I don't know what the campaigns are doing this cycle, but I would trust what the campaigns are doing more than what you're seeing in the news media, just because of basically methodology mm-hmm. and access to information.
And we believe it or not, had something similar in our campaign. We had, you know, I think the Obama campaign had the benefit of having sort of been a campaign for a much longer period of time. You know, we had sort of an internal battle going on between our pollsters and our political operation, which was sort of looking at this massive database as well and, you know, talking to thousands of people every single night and, you know, looking at head-to-head numbers that were not always consistent with our pollsters who were weighting data and, you know, taking these numbers and then trying to figure out who was actually going to show up and vote. And so there was an internal battle. I will say that our data operation in the primaries, with the exception of Alabama and Mississippi, which were on the same day, was spot on. I mean, our predictions and where we were the night before the election and what the turnout ended up being or what the results ended up being was spot on throughout the primaries with no waiting. And Alabama and Mississippi, it was a little bit off, and I sort of attributed that to sort of the evangelical effect at play there. But I agree with Stephanie. I'm very skeptical of any of these media polls because mostly they're looking for something cheap that they can write a headline on. And when you have, you know, a 200-sample internet poll that is like an opt-out, opt-in, opt-out, you know, it's just so unreliable right. that it's almost not worthy of even reporting on, and yet we're seeing them every single day in this race. And
they take on a momentum of their own.
And not only that, but it's now determining who's actually getting on the debate stage right. in the Republican primary. Right. And so that's a dangerous proposition that we're using something that's so faulty potentially to actually determine, you know, who, you know, the choices are going to be. For these voters. And so, you know, I would love to see the elimination of public polling altogether, you know, for the sake of fairness. I don't think that's ever going to happen.
No. All right, another question. Yes, right here, and then we'll make our way back to the middle.
Sure. Hello, my name is Caroline Katba. I have a question concerning what you think about whether there is actual value towards gaining in the polls or any PR value to a lot of candidates. There's a recent, you know, change. For example, Huckabee went to an illegal settlement in the middle, in the heart of the West Bank, to fundraise and to campaign. Trump is thinking about going to Israel. He recently canceled that trip until I become president, right? So do you
I
see
think maybe
any...
that trip was canceled for him, but we're not really sure.
I'm just reporting as the news reported, right? But I'm wondering, do you see any value in a lot of these candidates actually leaving mainland United States, right? And trying to campaign outside or fundraise outside while they can be using their valuable time to attend events here in the United States.
Thank you. So what's the value of international travel? You know, there's the beefing up your national security foreign policy bona fides.
I think I do think that there's some value, and it depends on the stage of the campaign. I think there's some value very early on to sort of go out and get educated, you know, prior to the 2012 campaign getting started. You know, Mitt was, you know, taking some trips and, you know, going and talking to, you know, generals in war zones and really getting, you know, information that you don't get without, you know, going there, I think is useful. Certainly, you know, on the Republican side, and Stephanie can speak more to this on the Democrat side, there's a lot of benefit to going to Israel. I mean, there's a significant, you know, group of donors on our side that are very interested in seeing their candidates get educated on issues related to Israel.
Some real downsides too, though.
If you make a gaffe. Yes.
If you don't have a lot of foreign policy experience, Israel's a tough start.
Well, and even if you do have foreign policy experience, you know, there's always potential for things to really blow up in your face. I was just going to say, I think when you get to a certain point in the primary cycle, taking that much time to travel is probably not really important to the voters of Iowa and New Hampshire. But then post-primary, you know, we made the decision to, you know, for Mitt to spend some time overseas. It's very fraught with risk, you know, and, you know, we thought this was a very safe thing for him to go to London right when the Olympics were happening. Right. This is a guy that's like Mr. Olympics. And of course, he was a little too Mr. Olympics and, you know, it turned into a thing. And, you know, so there is some risk to it. But I do think that it's important that the American people like to see their candidates sort of in that setting and evaluate, you know, their, you know, ability to hold up in a setting like that.
Like many things. When it goes well, it's a really good idea in hindsight. There was one more. I think we have time for one or two more. Yes, sir. In the blue tie right here.
Hi, Hugh Grindstaff. I'm a Republican who campaigned for Barry Goldwater in high school, who was on a draft Colin Powell committee in 1996, but who voted for John Kerry and John Edwards. And Trump has spent $217,000 on ads. Jeb Bush has spent $29 million. And on Sunday, I've asked my friends to have a non-Trump day on your Facebook. If you have Trump on your Facebook, you delete it. So how do you tell a politician it's time for him to get out? If you were Jeb Bush, you're spending $29 million, and how do you get Trump with all this free publicity out of the race?
It sounds like your question in part is the value of spending money and what it's actually buying you in this 2015-2016 cycle. Stephanie.
Well, I mean, no vote has been cast yet. So, and Jeb isn't spending his own money. So why would you get out at this point? And I'm not saying Jeb's going to win or has a shot or anything, but I think this is the calculation that they're making, any of them, that at this point, why get out? If you have the resources to stay in, no vote has been cast, you don't know what's going to happen between now and February 1st. Stay in and see what happens. And certainly, when the race starts to consolidate, it's any man's or woman's guess at how that race is going to consolidate. It's not going to stay, how many are we at now? 14?
15.
It's not going to stay 15 for very long. You know, again, I'm not saying that he's making wise investments or he has a shot, but I think that all of these guys are just taking a wait-and-see approach and to see if Trump blows up and where those votes go.
And as for the value of ads, you know, Trump is just a phenomenon. You know, I don't think that it necessarily means anything for future campaigns. He's just so different that you almost, you know, can't anticipate it ever happening again. But I will say this about the amount of money that Jeb has spent. And I have some very good friends on the Jeb campaign that don't appreciate me saying this, but if you don't have the right product, no amount of advertising is going to sell it. And that's New true. Coke found that out. And so right now, I mean, I talk to a lot of Republican primary voters who have great affection for the Bush family and really loved George W. Bush, loved his parents, who just say to me, you know, he's a good man, but I don't think it should be another Bush. I think that's not how this country has been built. And so they just sort of have decided to take him out of the equation, not because of anything he's done or not done. And there's no amount of advertising that's going to change that. And they almost feel kind of sad about it. Like, they feel badly that they can't be more devoted to him. But like I said, I don't think it necessarily means advertising doesn't work. I just think that, you know, they're not buying what's being sold.
We're out of time, but I'm going to award myself one very quick last question. In 10 seconds, would you go back in? If the phone rang and it were the right candidate, the right offer, would you do another campaign?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Stephanie, you swore you wouldn't at the beginning. Would you?
No, I wouldn't.
Stephanie has a child. I do not. So I probably would make a different decision if I were. But I love it. I do. I mean, I'm glad not to be in it this time for now, but I love it.
Do it again. All right. Thank you so much.
Katie Cocker, Stephanie Kennedy.
Thank you. That was a great discussion. Thank you, Stephanie. And thank you, Katie. Thank you to Mary Louise Kelly for a wonderful session. And I want to thank everyone here for joining us. And again, thank ExxonMobil for making this partnership and ongoing series possible. And have a great day, everyone. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you.